Have you ever wondered what the personality profile is of a narcissist so that you could spot them and avoid them? In this interview with Midori Verity and Carol Dysart, I'm going to uncover all of that for you. They are experts at this. They know how to use the DISC profile to actually figure out what narcissists look like and what their victims look like and teach you exactly how to spot them and how to avoid them yourself. So make sure you check out this video. Hi, I'm Rebecca Zung, and I've been recognized as one of the top 1% of attorneys in the country, and I also have a couple of best-selling books, Negotiate Like You Matter and Breaking Free, a step-by-step divorce guide. And on this channel and in these videos, I help people escape relationships with narcissists with real tools on actually how to negotiate with them, and that's what I do. So make sure you hit subscribe and you hit the notification bell, and that way you'll get notified when I upload new content. So now, without further ado, let's dive into my conversation with Midori and Carol. Welcome to another edition of Negotiate Your Best Life. I'm Rebecca Zung, and I'm so excited today to have two incredible ladies with me. I got the distinct honor of being on their show, and now after talking to them, I said, I have to have you on mine. This is so interesting. This is such great stuff. So I have Carol Dysart and Midori Verity here with me today, and we are going to be talking all about the personality profile of a narcissist, how to spot and avoid them. So let me just give a little bit of a bio of each of them. Carol Dysart is an internationally recognized mastery of personality science for decades of doing this. She's a highly sought after consultant for CEOs, business leaders, and influencer. And she is the co-founder of People Smart Enterprises and a total expert on DISC, which we're going to talk all about what that is. Midori Verity is a mindset coach, author, TV host, seasoned entrepreneur, 25 years she's been doing this. She assists ambitious professionals to achieve a higher level of success by replacing their subconscious mental barriers. And she is the founder of the Mox Life. So thank you, both of you, and welcome, Carol and Midori.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
So let's talk, let's go to you, Carol, first, and let's talk about this DISC assessment. It's funny because right before we got started, I was telling you guys that I just recently started working with a new business coach, and the first thing he wanted me to do was take the DISC assessment, and I said, oh, I already did it. I just did it like 2 months ago. So tell our audience what that is, Carol.
Great. I just, the DISC has been my favorite tool since I discovered it. I didn't write it or invent it, but when I was a high school teacher of high school students, I was thinking, how do I really get to these kids and reach them? And what about the parents who have made kids that tell me that they don't even want to go home for Thanksgiving? You know, they'd rather stay and visit with me in my office than go home for, I think there's something more to learn about people. So a friend invited me to her class training, and here was the DISC model. I had never heard of it. So just for those of you that don't know the name DISC or what they stand for, it's dominance is the D, influence is the I, steadiness is the S, and C is compliance to rules and regulations. The big deal is that all four of those styles, we all have all of them in us. We just, like an athlete develops certain muscles based on their sport, we develop certain strengths, and the intensity of the strength of each of the styles that we're most comfortable using is what comes out in our profile. And the profile is shown with a graph representation that can show the intensity. So that's the model. That's how you identify the model. It's a four quadrant model. If I hold my fingers up, you can see the there's a difference in intensity of speed. So people either are fast or slow in this dimension of our pace that we like to work at. That's a very important distinction to notice, by the way, when you're talking with people. And then the horizontal line is the difference between what we focus on, which is over on the left, or for your right, would be the task orientation, getting things done, bottom line, getting it right, being accurate, all of the kind of left brain category of things.
And over, I feel attacked. No, just kidding.
Depends on their intensity is how much they attack and the way they do it. And then on the right is people. So we have people or task and fast or slow. That's pretty easy to determine. But most people don't know how to translate what that style is and what to do with it when they get the speed or the focus. Now what? So DISC is a model that I never just sell across the counter, so to speak. I always insist that people get some sort of a backup and an interpretation so that they don't label people and misuse it or assume that they know what a dominance means, like you just said, attack. Not necessarily, but yes, dominance attack problems. They see the big picture. They attack in that way. But other styles feel that they are attacked. I think we're talking about gaslighting.
Yeah. So really fascinating, because I really enjoyed my time on your show where we talked about, you know, my DISC profile and how I do have dominance and that sort of thing. But that I actually tend, when I'm working in teams or in relationship with people, to like pull that back. You know, I noticed that you have like two different profiles. It's like your natural style, and then it's who are you when you're in a relationship, right?
It depends on their focus of when you're taking it. Are you focusing on yourself in a relationship, in a family, socially, or at work? Because the hat we wear to work is different than the one we wear socially out with our friends often, right? It's like also masks. Sometimes people talk about it as a mask, not the kind we're wearing these days, but the mask of, well, who do I want to show up to be? That is your adapted style. So the natural style is you at rest, at home, in your comfort zone. And then there's the style, the adaptation that you make. Some people make a lot of adaptation to fool people into thinking they're a certain way. Midori and I did a show on people who were, giving a false impression of who they were because they thought they had to be that way. But everyone has a way of being at home or relaxed and of being in their role. So whatever the role is what you're talking about.
Okay. And Midori, how does all of this relate to narcissistic tendencies?
The one thing, you know, it's hard to absorb all of this because DISC is quite elaborate, but people who tend to be narcissistic, you can start to see little patterns. So once you understand the basics of DISC, it can act as a tool, kind of a cheat sheet to recognize certain behaviors. We talked about D, the dominant personality style. Just because someone's dominant does not mean that they're a narcissist. So I want to make sure we're not pigeonholing anyone. But one type of behavior to watch out for is someone who comes across as needing to be in charge. That's just their role. That's the way they want to be. But more importantly, is how they treat you. And those are the things to pay attention to. Are they doing, I know, you know, Rebecca, that you've talked about this quite a bit on your show, is one of the big signs to watch out for is, are they love bombing you? That's one of the quintessential traits to pay attention to in the beginning when you're meeting someone who may potentially be a narcissist. The other thing that I tell my clients is to pay attention. Does it feel weird? Does it feel like it's not natural? Because sometimes people really are giving and they are loving and they want to make you feel good. However, if it feels highly unnatural, they're giving you too much too early, those are things to pay attention to. Fast forward, let's say you end up in a romantic relationship with someone who is a narcissist. There are a lot of other things to pay attention to that can give you big fat clues, such as, are they making you feel like you are inadequate? Are they challenging you? Do they always need to win every single argument? That's kind of that dominant personality style gone bad. So those are just some clues. Also, over time, are they not paying attention to you? Do you feel as though they are dominating you and making you feel less? So, you know, for you, Rebecca, I hope you don't mind me talking about this, but in our show, you brought up, you know, you're a powerful attorney and you've been successful, and I'm guessing you don't attract a lot of narcissists. However, one happened to weasel
two,
their way.
I had two.
Oh, two. Okay. That's right. Two that happened to get into your life one way or another. So they're very good at manipulating. They're very good at pulling the wool over your eyes. So no matter how educated you are on this, they can weasel themselves in. So you want to also pay attention to, what are those signs? How are they making you feel? Are you starting to question yourself? Are you starting to think that you're losing your mind? Were you confident in one area at one time, but now it's way down? You've lost your self-confidence in that area and you're starting to question yourself. So just really paying attention to how you're being affected. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think that that's really interesting. So, you know, and you started to get into what the next area is that we were going to be talking about. And I found this whole thing fascinating because, you know, I have had to deal with a couple of narcissists in my own life, and I'm not what people might think about as like a typical victim, you know, and that's why I thought that, you know, it'd be interesting to take your test and let you guys guinea pig me. And I was willing to just go, okay, whatever it is, I can hear it. I'll do it. But it was really fascinating to me because, you know, I was in these relationships. I mean, and I always tell people it wasn't husbands. It was a sort of in a business setting, and one was in a kind of an extended family member. And but the one in particular in the business setting was an interesting thing for me because I did start to question and I did start to feel things. And you started to touch on this a little bit, Midori, on what people should be asking themselves to help them realize if they're in an unhealthy relationship. Is there anything more that you want to add to that?
I could go on and on for hours on that topic. But there are some things that you can pay attention to. And one is paying attention to your gut. Really kind of diving in and reevaluate. If you've been with someone for 5 years, think about, where were you when you first met this person and where are you now psychologically? Were you once this vibrant, outgoing, confident person who was really social, and now you're kind of hiding, you're questioning everything, things that used to be simple for you. Now you're having a hard time making decisions because you don't trust yourself. You just got to kind of question that and see what's changed. Because when you are in a healthy relationship, this is any kind of, whether it's work, whether it's a romantic relationship, friend relationship, it's all the same. But those that are the healthiest make you rise up. They don't make you feel less confident and inadequate. So that's a really easy way to pay attention. And I want to talk about this client that I had because I hear this way too often and I don't want people to feel like they can't get out. I had a woman who called me recently and she was so upset she couldn't even talk and her daughter had to take over for her. She had been left by her husband of 23 or 24 years and she thought everything was fine. For that long of a period of time, she thought everything was fine. They were doing well financially. Their kids had gone to college. Things looked well on the outside. But then after he left and he started treating her horribly, taking all the money and basically detaching from the kids and from herself, she felt like she was totally lost because he had been taking care of her. So this is more typical of a narcissistic type of relationship where you have someone who is a person who is dominating, and then you have a person who's more of the steady type of person on the disc graph, which Carol hit on. So the steady person is the one who doesn't want to create waves. They won't ask questions as much. They want to keep the peace. This is the most common that I see with long-term narcissistic relationships, and the most devastating. So what had happened was she stopped asking him questions. She just kind of let him rule the roost. And then when he left, she found herself completely lost because he had taken care of everything. And so anyway, what we had to do was really kind of rebuild her and help her create a way to create independence and see how she, Carol taught me this part of it, see how she taught him how to treat her. That was a huge thing that I learned from Carol, is that she allowed him to be in charge. She allowed him to dominate. She allowed him to take away her independence and her confidence over the years without even really realizing it. That's why these shows, your show, is so important.
Oh, I love that you said that you teach people how to treat you. I mean, that's just so good. So, I mean, you touched a little bit on how the S is a personality style that will attract narcissists, you know. So, Carol, are there other personality styles that also attract narcissistic people?
Yes, all of the styles could potentially do it depending on their need. I wanted to point out every one of the styles is different, very different in their focus. The dominance wants big picture problems to handle. Their need is to be in control and have authority. Authority is a big deal. That's why so many, what we call narcissistic people, have the dominance at least a midline or higher in their profile graph, because there's a driving inner psychological human decision that has actually shown up on the outside once they're growing up to be what we call dominance behavior. I don't think children go through a menu and say, let's see what style I'm going to choose to be. No, they're all influenced by what works. What's their winning formula? When do they get the most attention? How do they survive? And so that drives often a behavior. It drives our careers. It drives a lot of things once we're aware. So awareness, self-awareness, first of all, is the most important thing that everyone needs to have. That's why DISC is such a popular model, because it's observable. People take it. It's not a threatening psychological analysis of you that someone's going to embarrass you about. It's what everybody already knows about you the minute you walk in the door. So you can't hide your style. But to somebody that's tuned in and trained in DISC, they can adapt, they can learn it. So the dominant styles tend to attack rather than attract, but it's not impossible. Another D style could try to dominate the dominant style. And that's where you find a lot more conflict. So the victim is generally not a very high dominance if there's two together. The influence, the I, which is on the fast-paced and people-oriented, they want everyone to love them. They want everybody to like and work with them because they get things done through and with people. They like a team. They like to pull things together. So, but they have a very high need for approval, and that is what a narcissist can tune in on and pick up exactly how to love bomb them, as you called it, and what to do to make them happy, because a high I will tell you everything they want you to know about how to make them happy. That's what they're good at, training people how to treat them. The steadiness and the compliance styles are on the lower intensity of energy spent in ego. Very little ego in the steadiness or the compliance cautiousness style, because they're focused on serving, supporting, the S for making sure the pace stays steady, the C, making sure the rules and the procedures are followed, and the facts are right. Just give me the facts. So the narcissistic person can tap into their lack of need for dominating or ego, you know, saying I'm strong, don't stomp on me. They won't speak up like that. They won't even tell you when they've done something great and brag about it. They were raised by usually parents who said children should be seen and not heard. It's not polite to talk about yourself. So they suppress their personal need and ego style. So that is what I've noticed is, you know, a predominant behavior, and they don't like conflict of any kind. So they will run away, hide back, slow down, swallow it, do everything they can not to be seen publicly or outwardly so somebody could hurt them. There's that kind of that barrier up all the time.
Yeah. So, you know, here's the $64,000 question. I totally date myself by even saying that. But anyway, I'm going to ask Midori, how do you repel a narcissist?
Well, you know, I had a client not too long ago, and one thing that we talked about was her stepping into this alter ego because she is a high S. That's just her natural tendency. And she's beautiful and amazing. She has a huge heart. So I didn't want to take that away from her. I didn't want her to feel like it wasn't okay to be who she was. However, this worked very, very well. What she did was she stepped into this alter ego when a person happened to approach her, and she got very good at figuring out who was narcissistic and who was okay, who was safe to be around, because that's something we worked on for 90 days. And what she did was she stepped into being Wonder Woman, and she would, you know, visualize herself with number one woman's bracelets. Oh, yeah. And yeah. Right.
I talked about that too.
It's all the same.
Yeah.
And so that's how she would envision herself. And so when she would see herself stepping into being that Wonder Woman person, she had an alter ego name as well, that she would all of a sudden encompass all the tools that she needed. So at that point, she wasn't, let's call her Susie. She was Wonder Woman, Jennifer, whatever we want to call her. And that's who she was. And so that is just psychologically a way to empower yourself so that if it doesn't feel comfortable because you are a different personality style that isn't used to that conflict or isn't comfortable with that conflict, you can become another person temporarily and switch your mindset and your behavior so that it does feel more comfortable for you.
Yeah, I think that's perfect. I often say that too, you know, especially when you're getting like attacked by a narcissist and they're saying things and they know how to say things that are absolutely your Achilles heel or the things that are going to bother you the most. You know, if it's really important for you to be a great dad, they'll call you a deadbeat dad. If, you know, they'll say you're a neglectful mother or something, you know, whatever it is, like the things that mean the most to you, that's what they'll go after. And so that's what I usually tell people with the Wonder Woman bracelets, like you just gotta let that go because that they're just saying it just to get a rise out of you, right? So, Carol, was there more you wanted to add about what the more passive styles, the S and the C, can do to empower themselves?
Yes, thank you. The really important thing is that people learn what their style is to begin with. Every parent, please note, teach your children how to recognize all four of the styles, not to try to turn them into another style than who they are. So you want to make it part of your training. I wish every school would do a DISC profile for their students. So the students grow up knowing they have strengths, they're prone to be really good because of their interest in one style or another. So an S person or a C person, a compliance that is, or a steadiness style, they need to be aware of their own style or they are automatically going to be a victim. There'll be a victim, if not to a narcissist, to just how everyone else wants the things to be done. And while they make excellent workers And 65% of our population actually is in the S and the C category. Yeah. It's really sad when people don't know who they are. That was, Aristotle or one of the early ancient Greeks that said, know thyself. That piece is so important. Once you see your style, then like a detective, you can go and find out all about how people with your tendencies, because you're not the only one in the planet with this style, how do other steadiness people act and how are they seen and do they have to stay a steadiness? No, you don't have to stay whatever style you've been born into. You adapt and get that style pretty early in life because of the environment, I believe, that you're put in, the, you know, parents and teachers. But like an alien on the face, unless you know and have your style yourself, so you can take it off, put it on, adapt it, adjust it. If you don't know that style, it has you, you don't have it. That's why you have to tell people to teach people how to treat you. Well, if you don't know what your style is, you're not going to know how to teach them either, because you won't be aware of yours is different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you might think you're a certain way when you're not or something like that.
Yeah.
So Midori, how does somebody break that pattern of attracting narcissists, you know, to them, or being attracted to narcissists? You know, the empaths out there think that they can save the world, right? So how do you stop this? Stop the madness.
Right. No, that's a great question. What I say is there's three A's. The first one is to have awareness. So shows like this and reading and just really figuring out what is it that you're attracted to in these narcissists? What is the behaviors that you have noticed in the people who bring you down? And write it out. Physically write it out so it's in front of you and become aware of that. The next part is very important. It's the action. So what are you going to do the next time someone who's narcissistic comes into your life, or someone who has been in your life in the past and they're a narcissist comes back? So this is that revolving door with relationships, right? So often we see these relationships that are so destructive and people stay in them for one reason or another, but that's why it's so important to have an action plan. So when that person comes in, you know what you're going to do. It's very clear. You don't have to second guess it. You don't get caught back with going into old patterns of codependency or feeling inadequate. Instead, you know what kind of words you're going to use. You know how you're going to look at them in the eye, and you know when you're going to leave. So that's such an empowering feeling when you know how you're going to act. And so with that, that's going to build up your confidence right there. And then the third A is accountability. So if this is something that has really plagued you and caused you a lot of problems, have a best friend who you trust and is strong, or a coach or a psychologist, someone there to help keep you in line. So when you start noticing, oh my gosh, I really miss Johnny, who, and you start forgetting all those negative things that he did to you, you have that person that you go to who reminds you and helps you stay on that action plan that you had.
Perfect. I love that. So this has been so enlightening, and I really, really appreciate both of you and such wisdom and perspective on the personality profile of a narcissist. Where can we learn more about each of you and your show? And I know you guys have like a link to do a free DISC profile.
Yeah, but where you can find all of that you just talked about is if you go to limitlessyou.today, and that's where you can go and take the DISC profile. It's a pretty general one. If you want to do one that's more specific, there are options for that as well. But at least if you take the general one, you will learn where you stand on the DISC, and then you can decide what you want to do after that. Also, as far as information on Carol and myself, it's there as well. So that's the one stop, limitlessyou.today.
Awesome. I love it. So, Carol, if you wanted to leave one piece of advice with our community, our listeners, I'm going to ask you first and then Midori, what would the one thing you would say would be?
Oh, know and love yourself just for who you are and strengthen that style in every way that is pleasurable and meaningful to you. Your purpose is within your reach when you know your style, and nothing can take you away when you know who you are.
I love that. And Midori?
I would just say create an awareness. Create awareness of who you want to be, who you want to recognize yourself as, how you want others to see you, and then also, of course, who you want to repel. So really creating an awareness can help you make the right choices.
Yes, who you want to be and who you don't want in your world.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. Thank you both so much. This is so interesting. I love this stuff. And go, everybody, go take that free disc test. What was the website again? Say it one more time.
LimitlessU.today.
All right, LimitlessU.today. And we'll make sure to put it in the show notes as well. Go take the free test and find out who you are and who you don't want in your life. All right. Thank you both so much.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks. Bye.
Thanks for joining me on this episode of Negotiate Your Best Life and this interview with Midori and Carol. Make sure you go check out what their resources are and take your DISC assessment. I'm curious to see what you end up coming out as. Okay. So make sure that you like this video, you share it, you drop me a comment, let me know what your DISC profile says, and also subscribe and hit the notification bell. You also feel free to join me in my free private Facebook group at Narcissist Negotiators with Rebecca Zung, and also, download your free Crush My Negotiation prep worksheet at winmynegotiation.com. Thanks so much, and I will see you in the next video.